This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Infinite Perspectus. Author: Ernest Leland Norman. Year: 1929. Preface. It will be conceded by all those who read this book that it excels both in quality and quantity any other expressive element in the curriculum of Unarius. It is also presented without compromise or apology, for none is needed, despite what might seem to be revolutionary concepts aimed at destroying all conformities. It is, as with all other vehicles of Unarian concepts, a book created as a tool which can be used by any individual to dig himself out of the burrow of his material existence. It is a book which compounds within itself all of the vastness of infinity. It is at once provable in the dimension of present-day science and in personal relationships to the world, yet terminates at no point, either here or hereafter. The breadth, depth, and scope of its contents cannot and will not be more fully realized by any reader, even after a lifetime of study. Indeed, he will be vitally concerned with its message, even into the most remote corners of infinity. It may be interesting to note that unlike most other Unarius books and lesson courses, it did not start as a preconceived effort in a book form, but started rather as several taped lectures which could be utilized in group meetings which were forming all over the country. However, spirit was not to be denied. The two or three original lectures grew into 33, and aside from this indicative number, the net content is not only a summation of past presentations, but also contains many new and technical abstractions not previously presented. After these lectures were so recorded, they were presented to the Unarius student as a means to more thoroughly acclimate him with the entire proceedium. It was felt that through the recorded voice, new power could be projected to the student when he listened to the message. The response to these taped messages, individually speaking, was very great. All persons who so listened to them reported great progress, as well as more paranormal realizations, activities, and manifestations. It was at this point that Ruth began to realize the importance of these taped messages in the written word or book form, and so they were thus transcribed word for word, followed by the usual process of vari typesetting performed by Velma, editing, etc., and have finally found their way into the covers of this book. Perhaps it might be well to interject a final note of introspection. The presentation of the infinite is indeed, under any circumstances, an extremely difficult if not impossible task, especially when it is considered that such vehicles of transposition, human speech, word forms, etc., must be used at least autosuggestively to activate the mind of the student. This mind or consciousness, too, is not a very suitable place to transplant the breadth and scope of infinity, as every human has lived the singular, chain-like, reactionary sequence form of life. It is extremely difficult to transpose this vision of infinity, and even more so to grasp its entirety. Nor is it reasonably supposed that this prodigious feat can be accomplished, but rather a more evolutionary pattern of life, which integrates these factors into future lifetimes and their evolutionary phases should take place. This book must also try to accomplish its purpose with people from many strata of life. It must appeal to the scientist, the pseudo-religionist, the agnostic, and the illiterate. It must be provable in all aspects, in all dispensations, and especially with the future. Read, therefore, its contents with an open mind, freed as much as possible from personal opinions and prejudices. Its contents were compounded and delivered by those who have advanced far beyond the necessity of earth life, people who, at one time, like you are now doing, pass through these various phases of third-dimensional evolution. They present to you this, the Unarian concept, the entirety of infinity compounded together with a vast intellectual power which will permeate your consciousness and into your psychic anatomy, and will help you in all ways, manners, and forms to accomplish your most ultimate destiny, to progress progressively and infinitely into the future. Ernest L. Norman. Author, Director, Moderator of Unarius, Science of Life. Chapter 1. Greetings, friends. This is indeed a most joyous and happy occasion. And so far as my own personal feelings are concerned, this joy is not some selfish joy in which I may be vindicated in my personal beliefs, or that I gain satisfaction in some such manner or form, but rather the joy I feel is for each and every one of you, for I know, as you are seeking further knowledge of Unarius, you have taken at least one positive step forward in expressing a certain quotient in the dynamic expression of infinite creation. This in itself is most important, and something which you should always remember throughout the coming years, and in the times when you are troubled or emotionally distressed, that always there must be a consciousness of this infinite expression which is working directly in a regenerative principle, to constantly recreate for you the form and substance of your lives, and rather than to continuously indulge yourselves in past emotional reflex experiences born from out other worlds and other times, it is most imperative that you learn to recognize this infinite creation, which is above and beyond the immediate horizon of these various reactionary and emotional experiences. In other words, there is always a positive and creative motion involved, even though it may apparently seem to you that such happenings or intents at the moment are destructive in nature. When this more positive and most necessary attunement and introspection begins to be attained, you will realize that there is infinitely much more in progressive evolution than you have heretofore imagined. Not only that, but you will actually begin a constructive evolution which will automatically in itself express into your outward or exterior life the better quotients and qualities of life as they have up until some point only been dreamed of by yourself. This point could perhaps be best illustrated by telling you a story, one which has possibly happened in innumerable cases and in varying situations. It concerns a small child who was being scolded by her father for being naughty. After the scolding, the child looked up at her father with innocent eyes and expression and asked this question, "Why can't I be naughty, Daddy?" You can well imagine what the father thought at that particular moment, and how his intelligence was taxed to come up with a suitable and direct answer to this very naive question. Perhaps he used the number one stock answer which most fathers give to such questions, because God doesn't want you to be naughty. Now, this is all well and good to a certain point, but it must be remembered that from that moment on, the child would pass through life with more or less of a subconscious sense of fear that some God was looking over her shoulder at every moment in her life. In this respect, we can easily visualize adults as grown-up children, and they have passed through their lives in a sense, feeling subconsciously or consciously that some God or some deification has, in a mysterious way, been looking at their various actions. Under pretense of moral codes or ethics, we can say that such constructive motivations which may arise in the daily intercourse of human beings among themselves must primarily be spurred and motivated or instigated by such thoughts and actions, or such visualizations as can be considered creative in nature. In the personal interpretation of thought into action, some element or quotient of this infinite creative principle is expressed, rather than doing something simply because it was necessary, or it was expected of us, or that in some way we were being intimidated by an unseen deification. It is at this point, when we evolve into that state of consciousness in which we are beginning to express in our daily thoughts and actions a certain creative quotient of the ever-regenerating infinite expression, that our lives begin to change. This consciousness will, in itself, supplant and replace the old reactionary elements which we have heretofore been practicing and by which we have been victimized in the past. To further enlarge our introspection, let us see that humanity as a whole has been living not only the immediate or physical life as it so appears, but individually every person has lived many hundreds of lives and passed through the same temporal experiences, and these things in themselves have only assumed new forms, new derivations, and new expressions, but basically all remained, categorically speaking, in the realm of the emotional reflex. There was not at any time a direct consciousness or a connotation to a higher and heretofore unknown principle of life. Today, our modern 20th century science has created a great paradox. This in itself is simply the general extraction of science or abstraction, as it so concerns our material world and is reducible into certain principles of creative and expressionary energy. Even the atoms of mass itself are so subdivided into energy particles known as electrons and protons. It is therefore a great and rather obvious mystery that man has not, up to this moment, applied the same creative principles of reconstruction and reconstructive infinity into his own daily life, as it concerns the more immediate function of such daily action and thought as can be considered psychological in nature. And here again, man is still at the present moment being victimized and is practicing the same subversive elements as he has always done. Religion in itself, and to define a religion according to Webster's dictionary, is merely a code of ethics by which we conduct ourselves from day to day. This is rather a broad frame of reference and one which gives considerable latitude in interpretation. To the religionist, there is somewhat of a different classification inasmuch as religion is more purely confined to such expressionary elements as can be found and seen being practiced in various temples and churches throughout the world. In analyzing these diverse religions and their backgrounds of historical interpretations, it is always found that these various religions are merely extractions and readaptations of older existing beliefs, which had their origin in more barbaric or pagan eras of time. So far as the existing 20th century science is concerned, such deifications and the suppositions which are concurrently being expressed by the many religious orders are purely fictional in nature, and as of this time and place, cannot be verified in a scientific manner. This difference between science and religion, so far as the existing multitudes of the world are concerned, poses a great and rather confusing problem. And until the individual becomes more thoroughly acquainted with science in a more universal or interdimensional aspect, he is hopelessly lost in the maze of conflicting opinions and expressions which are so concurrently being expressed. It is for this purpose that Unarius is now being presently expressed on the planet Earth. And while this movement has not yet gained the proportions or the strength which it will have in the future, it is the beginning of an era or an epoch of time through which man will take definite and progressive steps into a more comprehensive understanding of interdimensional factors which concern his everyday life. Every day, we can read accounts of various rockets or intercontinental missiles being fired by our scientists in an attempt to probe space. Around the outer fringes of our atmosphere, there are also numbers of satellites which have been and are being used by science in the same effort to probe the vast unknown. These are all healthy symptoms and show man's curiosity in an evolutionary way to comprehend the more fundamental aspects of a creative and universal intelligence, such as has heretofore been largely supplied by religious beliefs in their various deifications. To serve a more ultimate purpose, therefore, in the science of Unarius, you are taking a direct shortcut into the future, to a time and place when the scientist and the general populations of the world will understand, to some degree, and in some like manner, the principles of science which you are now reading in your Unarius books and lessons. It is therefore logical to assume that by the same level of reference and in viewing your evolution, as it is concerned with so many past lifetimes, that you have been, in a sense, saved from innumerable karmic earth lives and the attendant untold suffering which always goes hand in hand with these various expressionary factors. In this respect, in viewing such constructive evolutionary factors with which you are now primarily concerned, I can only urge you to continue in whatever manner and form is best suited to serve this purpose, and with the greatest possible strength, to constantly maintain within yourselves the same constructively minded evolution which I have tried to describe to you. Ever and uppermost in your minds must remain that principle of constructive evolution. Regeneration in such a constructive manner and form is the paramount principle of the creative intelligence. Always this is a progressive, forward, dynamic movement which is constantly regenerating itself into new and different forms, yet always with the same basic similarities which have previously been manifest. This is a relationship of positive and negative cyclic forms which has been explained to you in the lesson courses. You, as individuals in your daily lives, are constantly expressing certain quotients or various expressionary forms of these different wavelengths of energy, which are not only stemming from your psychic anatomy, but which are constantly being harmonically linked and relinked through consciousness into your exterior world. Bearing in mind this progressive principle of constructive evolution, it is therefore of the utmost importance that your evolution into the future shall maintain an equilibrium. This equilibrium consists of equal portions of knowledge which you so acquire in the study of these infinite principles, compounded together into equal portions of practical usage and application. In this prescription, you will find that magic elixir of life which has long been sought after by the ancients, and which composes some very vivid portrayals of historical accounts, some fictional, some true. But in the compound of your future lives, if they are so integrated with equal portions of knowledge of the future, and of the interdimensional principle of regenerative action, compounded with equal portions of positive useful application, then indeed you will have compounded that magic elixir of life, and it will surely give you eternal life. Life lived in far-off distant planets and in conditions which are beyond your present comprehension. This is not to be feared, but rather it is to be looked forward to with joy and anticipation. For if this evolution is so constructively compounded in the manner which I have described, then indeed there is nothing to fear. At this point, it might be well to more properly define these two important ingredients which we must enter into our compound of the magic elixir. The various books and lesson courses of Unarius explain quite adequately the knowledge which must be used, while the nomenclature and diverse depictions are, to some extent, part of our modern classical 20th century science, yet they in themselves are inviolate. That is, in whatever particular perspective we wish to describe them, they could ultimately be resolved into these configurations. And at whichever point we wish to discern ourselves in arriving in some future spiritual evolution, we will be involved with these principles regardless of nomenclature or the idiom of the time. So far as action is concerned, however, here is a distinct departure from what has heretofore been considered action in a third-dimensional way. For action is usually associated with some physical manipulation or some prescribed mental extrusion. This is far from that which can be more correctly discerned as true spiritual action. For indeed, we must make a complete departure from all past customs, observances, and various conscious or physical expressions which related action to us in our past lives. Under no circumstances should we continue to indulge ourselves in such conscious expressions of action as are generally associated with the material world. So far as the metaphysical teachings or religions of this time are concerned, these too are utterly false and without basic scientific origin or concept. It must always be remembered that the physical mind is merely an extrusion of the psychic anatomy, a sort of surface place where certain energy configurations reassume in their various confluxions a regular pattern, which in its reverse phase constitutes a thought. A thought is, as is done in photography, sort of a negative, then a reprint of the positive. This is what most people call thought. Therefore, such actions, mentally speaking, as are associated with concentration, prayer, supplication to various fancied deities, the visualization of some particular physical attainment, such as a new car, a new home, or other such particular dimensional aspects, is also quite false, and is merely another assumed form of the age-old practice of witchcraft, sorcery, and numerous other paganistic expressions. Action in its pure sense resolves into a fourth-dimensional aspect, associated as a culminated effort between the superconscious self, which is a polarized abstraction of the infinite, in conjunction with various mental and subconscious dimensions of the psychic anatomy. In this respect, it can be rightfully assumed that power is originating in its proper place from whence all things originate, in the higher dimensions, sometimes called the fourth or fifth, thus correctly stemming, as it were, into the person's life. Should such a person indulge himself in the capricious practices of mental projections or any of the many such concentrated efforts which are supposed to give him power and dominion over the physical world, then he will surely be obstructing the true flow of power from the inner or higher self. Action must always be superimposed on the consciousness as a function of the infinite which is flowing into the person from the higher abstract superconsciousness. It is polarized most properly with various perspectives in the individual's immediate life, so that this power will appear upon the surface in his daily life as the correct perspectives of personal relationship. It is therefore immediately seen that such appearances will be well ordered. They will be quite miraculous in nature in many instances. There is no preconceived, meditative, concentrated, or projected effort made in this direction. All things will be harmoniously attuned and will appear at the precise moment when they are needed. Such sundry other attributes as mental telepathy, attunement with not only the entire physical world in all its various transpositions, but an attunement with the higher worlds will also be quite possible and entirely feasible, and will become an actual reality. To properly instigate such mental consciousness as an action into your daily lives simply resolves into a formula in which you must realize that you are actually engaged in its infinite number of ingredients. Your daily physical life is the appearance of form and substance from another world at another time, and so cyclically interposed as to have some definite meaning with you in the present. It is also realized as correct attunement is made with various perspective relationships with the higher worlds, that they in turn can manifest and remanifest in certain perfected cyclic movements within your daily life. Such attunement is, of course, hard to come by. You have, as a creature of evolution, sustained your different lives from one life to the next, just as you do your daily life. A subconscious association and reassociation in the memory consciousness of the subconscious part of the psychic anatomy. This also has been adequately described to you in the second lesson course. It is only fair to state at this time that you cannot hope to achieve this new attunement, this new perspective of consciousness, in a few hours' time, nor can you do so in one lifetime. It will remain a challenge with you for many thousands of years to come, and their subsequent lifetimes. It is the challenge of the future. It is one way in which you attain infinite knowledge. For in that theoretical supposition of time and place, when you have achieved a direct relationship with the infinite, to such a perfected degree that you are no longer reactionary in any sense or manner, then indeed you will be endowed with all of the godlike propensities and proclivities. For the present, however, there are a few rules to remember. Do not resort to any of the mind practices which are commonly associated in your present time, such as concentration, prayer, or in the supposed belief that you regulate fate in any sense of the word, purely because fate, as it is generally supposed, is non-existent. True fate is the direct extracted derivation of various cyclic movements which occur within your psychic anatomy, and in which, to a large extent, you, in the past, instituted and relegated this so-called fate by your previous actions. So does the future hold the same promise, that as of today, you are relegating yourself into whatever particular dimension to which you so aspire. It is conceivable, therefore, in your study of Unarius, you are making a serious and concerted effort to aspire into a higher dimension of interpretation. While it is well and good to have certain idealisms or aspirations, it is much more logical if we can possess the power of perception within ourselves to attain these various idealisms. Principally, the way to a higher life is never achieved from selfish reasons. That is, we have some ulterior motives within our subconscious selves which have been born from out the old insecurities of the past lives. We are still creatures of a primitive world living under the law of survival of the fittest, the carnal law of the jungle. Aspirations and idealisms must be born from an entirely new concept, that you are beginning to function as an integral part of the infinite consciousness, that your ultimate destiny is participation in a universal, reconstructive, and regenerative infinity. You cannot do this if you are motivated by selfish reasons, by ulterior motives, or by reasons which are mandated by some of the subconscious fears of insecurity. Participation in the infinite and becoming such a universally participating element or entity mandates an obvious fact that you must learn of this infinity, learn of it, its function, and its relationship to even greater infinities. Mark Twain once said, "Everybody talks about the weather, but nobody does anything about it." This is quite true about the general philosophical idealisms, religions, etc., of our time. Everyone is talking about survival after death, as is posed in various religious orders. Everyone yearns for eternal life. To the average Earth individual, nothing is more fearsome than the sudden extermination of his physical life. The person who is more securely indoctrinated in the higher expressionary principles of infinite regeneration does not have such fear, but rather he knows that life is supported as a continuity from one cycle to the next, and carries with it an agent of transmission, the entire entity of being, the reason within itself, the knowing of certain unalterable basic principles of life. These in themselves are the immortal elements that refuse to perish with the passage of time, or the advent of, so-called, death. Any person who wishes to survive this life, and in an intelligent manner, without incurring the usual karmic impregnations which come through lack of knowledge, must do so by becoming acquainted with the principles of function as they concern the infinite. So far as the sciences and religions of this day are concerned, there is much talk about these things as to the sustaining of life beyond the third dimension and to the possibility of life on distant planets, yet apparently no one seems to know how this is done or what reality exists beyond the mortal ken. This is the purpose of Unarius, to supply these missing ingredients. And like the little girl who asked her father, "Why can't I be naughty?" So people have in their past evolutions through time and space, to the present, in their many lives, reincarnated back into a terrestrial life which has fostered their very beginnings. These people, too, are beginning to learn that they can't be naughty. The reasons are not, as they are generally supposed, but are based entirely upon a constructive presentation of evolution as it concerns the personal entity in traveling into time and space, traveling into a higher dimension of consciousness where the physical life is no longer lived in the customary manner mandated by the laws of the jungle. Therefore, it would be well at this time to go within yourselves to make a solemn vow that as of this moment, as of this time, you will spend your life, your eternity in learning of the infinite. You will know that in the learning there will come a higher sense of consciousness which will supersede any voluntary conscious mind function which you might make. You will cease to resort to the common paganistic practices which smack of age, old superstitious witchcraft, sorcery, and various other spirit practices used in the barbaric past. Instead, there will come within yourself the gradual realization, the consciousness of the great and vast infinite, and with this consciousness there will be relayed into your life a certain proportion of perfection. Idealisms will come about in a natural, functionable manner which is most perfect and miraculous to see, and you will know at that time your identity, your personal being, as an integrating participant in the function of universal consciousness will be sustained through eternity. So let us go forward. Each moment, each hour, each day is precious. We must use all this time remaining to us in this third dimension to do all we can to further or progress our evolution into a higher consciousness. This we must do, or we shall surely perish. Chapter 2. In various places throughout the works of Unarius, great emphasis has been placed upon the concept of obsession, and because of its importance to us in our daily lives and in our future evolution, it might be well at this time to enter into some more extensive and technical aspects of this all-important subject. No doubt all of you have at one time or another seen pictures, such as TV or motion pictures depicting witch doctors or medicine men adorned with sundry feathers, beads, and trappings, who were shaking bells or rattles and other numerous noisy instruments, and were dancing around some sick person in an attempt to scare out the evil spirit or spirits which were obsessing this person. The man of medicine, or the psychiatrist of our civilization, does not recognize this type of obsession. There are psychologically...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.